Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship at Westminster and to our inclusive family of faith. We especially welcome our visitors and those joining us on YouTube. Prayer for illumination. God, source of all light, by your word, you give light to the soul. Pour out on us the spirit of wisdom and understanding that our hearts and our minds may be open. Amen. Our New Testament reading is Hebrews 4, 12 through 16. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive the mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Our gospel reading today comes from Mark 10, verses 17 through 31. Remember that we have been traveling through Mark 9 and 10 as Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. Listen to this. As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." He said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Well, then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news who will not receive a hundredfold now in this age, houses, brothers, sisters, mother and children and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Every day we wake up, and there are things we must do. They varied from household to household, day by day, but we share a lot in common. Eat breakfast, put out the trash and recycling, brush our teeth, go to appointments or school or work, watch Jeopardy, feed children or pets or both, hug children or pets or yourself, sleep, do it all over again. What are the must-dos in your life? Those things that if you miss out, the whole world feels wrong? What are the things you hold on to tightly to make sense of daily life? A rich young ruler in today's text from Mark 10 is also wondering what else he must do. From context clues, we can determine that he was not only a moral and religious man, for he had kept all the commandments on how to treat his neighbors, but also that he had wealth and status and power. In Jesus' time, if someone was wealthy, it was assumed to be God's favor on them. And if someone was poor, it was assumed to be a moral failing. And I said Jesus' time, but maybe this is one area where not all that much has changed. So here we have a good guy who, by all accounts, is doing what he's supposed to. Yet something must be nagging at him, So he pursues Jesus on the way to find out what else he must do to get this inheritance that's due. As all of this spills out of him, Jesus looks at him and loves him. This is the only time we're told that Jesus loves a particular person in Mark, and we don't know exactly why Jesus loves him. Is it because he's faithful? Because he's striving for a higher righteousness? Because he knows that Jesus is good like God? Is it because he's powerful and yet willing to learn, rich and yet loves his neighbor? Before he had taken Jesus' advice, before he comes and follows Jesus, Jesus is already looking at him and loving him. But then Jesus offers a hard teaching, fitting in with this larger passage on discipleship and being like little children. "Sell all your stuff," he says, though lovingly, "and give it to the poor." The man walks away and the disciples are astonished. If that perfect specimen of faith and God's favor couldn't inherit eternal life, what hope was there for the rest of us? So Jesus tries to explain again that those who hold on to too much stuff can't fit at the table in God's kingdom. It'd be as hard as getting a camel through the eye of a needle. He goes on to describe the amazing gifts, with a little side of potential persecution, that come with following Jesus, that come with letting go and submitting to God's reign. This is one of those passages that very few people want to take literally. We'd rather focus on maybe our spiritual lives or feeding the hungry or even church history than face Jesus' teaching here. But what do you think Jesus teaches and preaches about more than anything else? I'll accept real live guesses. Love? What do you guys think Jesus teaches or preaches about more than anything else? Faith?
Money?
Life? Any other guesses? About how the pews should go in the church? No? No? Is that not it? Miles, what do you think? Greatness. Ooh, these are all really good things that Jesus does talk about. So good job, everybody. Hope? Are we here? Love? Hope? I want everybody to pat yourself on the back. Because these are all things Jesus talks about. Good job. Except the pew thing. Don't worry about that one. But it's true. It's not actually faith, hope, or love. It's not prayer. It's not life. It's not abortion. It's not the humanity of LGBTQ people. It's not how we should paint the church. It's money. Good job, Jim Johnson. In the New Testament, 17 out of Jesus' 38 parables have to do with possessions and giving. And where he spends 371 verses on prayer, he spends 2,100 on money. Judging from Jesus' teaching and preaching, he's much more concerned about what we do with what we have than he is our beliefs or our perfect doctrine. It's to that Christ that this rich young man comes to with his burning question, seeking sincerely, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What must I do to inherit eternal life? Well, what do any of us do to inherit anything? Well, we're born to the right family that has anything to pass down via blood. To inherit is an expectation that comes with having an entitlement to family heirlooms. And then the further implication of the rich young man is that he is somehow in control of acquiring this inheritance, that the rich young man would like to make sure his checklist looks like God's must-do list. But entering the kingdom of God is not based on what we inherit by right of birth, or what we are entitled to. God's kingdom is about getting exactly what we aren't owed, getting more than we could ever dream of. Entering into God's kingdom is not about anything that we do, even on our very important must-do list. Instead, entering God's kingdom is about grace. God's kingdom is about being welcome, especially if we weren't welcome in other kingdoms. God's kingdom is not about inheriting or earning, but instead about grace upon grace, building a new family and having new values around money, status, and power. It's about letting go in order to receive, embracing uncertainty with a hope and a hunger and faith for what else God has in store. Uncertainty, hope, hunger, sorrow. I'm not just talking about last night's Texas OU game or the season finale of Ted Lasso. But these themes run through this passage and our lives. Former pastor and author Rob Bell tells a story of his young son on a mission to claim the riches of the sea. The boy was running up and down the beach, collecting anything he could find. You know those broken parts of seashells? It was all a treasure to the boy, and he was filling up his hands. And then Rob looked out to the water and saw a perfect starfish floating on a wave. He excitedly pointed to the starfish and told his son, "Go get that starfish, it's yours." And the boy ran out a little way into the ocean to get it, but then came back. Rob encouraged him to go farther into the water, and so his son ran out farther, but then came back again. One more time, Rob sent him out saying, "Go get it, it's yours." But the boy returned without the starfish. Rob couldn't understand. Why wasn't his son getting that awesome gift of the ocean? Tearfully, his son lifted up his hands, fists tightly clutching all those broken shells. He couldn't get the starfish without letting go of what was in his hands. Holding on to those broken shells so tightly meant that he couldn't fulfill this greater gift of receiving a whole beautiful starfish. Have you ever held on too tight and missed something greater? Have you ever stuck too closely to your must-do list that you miss opportunities of grace right in front of you? Has your uncertainty and hunger led you to miss the hope found in our resurrected Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? Will asking to follow Jesus Christ more closely lead you to sorrow, surprise, salvation? We never hear about the rich young man after this conversation. The traditional interpretation here is that he walks away grieving because he cannot do what Jesus asked, that he can follow the commandments to a T, but he cannot let go of his stuff. Most scholars interpret his walking away from the way that Jesus is on means that Jesus' answer to his question is too great for him to bear, that his possessions are worth more to him than eternal life. But I wonder, what if he walks away grieving precisely because he is going to sell all his stuff and give it to the poor? What if when he asked the question, "What must I do?" he really meant it? He knew who Jesus was. He calls him good teacher, and as Jesus points out, only God is good. He knows the commandments are meant to shape our lives together, and so he follows them. What if he was ready for the next step? What if he knew this stuff was in the way? What if this is not a story of someone whose obstacles were insurmountable, but instead someone who gave up everything to follow Jesus? What if we never hear of him again because he became like every other poor peasant following Jesus? And maybe to do what was impossible alone, to sell all his stuff, he needed this wisdom and teaching and love from Jesus Christ. Maybe he listened to more of Jesus' teaching and preaching and knew that in God's kingdom, the rich are brought down and the lowly are lifted up so that they can sit at the same table. And he was willing to do that. Maybe he was a witness in the crowd as Jesus was put on trial and then crucified, with the full realization dawning of what it means to be a part of God's inheritance. Maybe he heard the whispered rumors 3 days later of resurrection and finally understood the depths of what Jesus means when he says, with God, all things are possible. Our sanctified imagination here can show us two options: a rich young man who was sorrowful because he couldn't follow Jesus, or grieving because he could. It's like just when we think we have it all figured out, we only score 10 points in the second half and lose to Oklahoma. I mean, just when we think we have it all figured out, following the commandments, God upends our expectations and shows us how losing is good, that last place is first place, that we must leave everything in order to receive everything and so much more. Friends, more than anything else, wherever you are on your journey this morning, I hope you feel Jesus' eyes on you. Jesus sees you where you are, and he loves you. He loves you for trying to follow God's commandments, for adding being part of a faith community on your must-do list. He loves you for all the things you have learned and unlearned, for all the steps you have taken towards obedience to God. And because he loves you, he calls you and you and you and you and me to come and follow him. Because he loves us, he knows the stuff we need to leave behind for that to happen. Because he loves us, he tells us the truth. Sell all that you have and give it to the poor. Out of that love, Jesus calls the rich young man and us to more. What must I do? What must we do to inherit eternal life? We must let go. Let go of preconceived notions of what we deserve, what we are owed. We must let go. Let go of any idea that we are in control of our salvation and eternal life. We must let go. Let go of the material possessions and wealth that define us, those things in our lives that are more precious than God's grace. What must we do? Follow Jesus wherever he leads us, into comfort and challenge and beyond. Thanks be to God for the gift of amazing grace and eternal life. Amen. And as you go out into the world, hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil, but strengthen the faint-hearted, help the suffering, and support the weak. Honor all people, loving and serving and rejoicing in the power of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.